name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord, the Most High. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord, Lord Most High. Holy is the name of the Lord. A strong tower, the righteous run into it, and they are saved. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord, Lord Most High. Strong tower, the righteous run into it, and they are saved. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord, the Lord Most High. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
The Lord. Good to be in God's house tonight, isn't it?
Amen.
Amen. I'm trying to find. Hang on a second. We're so glad to be in God's house on this Sunday evening. He's so good to us. I want to go to the Lord in prayer, and I want to name off several names here. Once again, if you did not get a bulletin, be sure to get that for the prayer list. Let's pray for these needs. We want to continue to pray for our missionaries and all of our missions projects. We have several of them. We mention them on Wednesday night quite often, but Heart of Florida Youth Ranch, we want to really remember them. Brother Sweet, his wife passed away this past week. They're having her funeral service tonight, a matter of fact. So pray for him and pray for the ranch there. I know it's a tough time for them. Also, Seamark Ranch, Harvest Time Juvenile Ministries, Europe's Child Mission, River of Life International, New Life Ministries, which is Brother Hanks, and that's Philippines, Africa, Sudan, all around the world. He is still in contact and working right now. The latest project that we've been a part of is, of course, the work in Guatemala. We've sent the funds there, but we've also sent him funds to help with the 20-something orphans from the Muslim attack on a church here a few weeks ago, leaving 24 orphans, killing the pastor as well. And it's just been a trying time for them. So continue to pray for those there in Sudan, and believe in the Lord just to touch them and to strengthen them and to help them. And so many missionaries, we might not financially support them, but they're missionaries around the world. And there's some of them that would typically come back to the States to raise funds, and some have not been able to do that. They're there. So let's pray for that. Let's pray for home mission works. I got a friend of mine that does homeless ministry downtown, Brother Johnny Brown. Just continue to pray for stuff like that as well. There's all kinds of local missions that goes on, and a lot of opportunities to do work for the Lord. So pray for them. Pray for our nation. Pray for our leaders. More so than ever before, I believe that we need to be praying in that behalf. Brother and Sister Paget, he's still hanging in there. So let's just continue to pray for both of them. Sister Joyce Mills Patterson, she's doing better, but she still needs a touch in her body. Sister Shirley, we want to continue to pray for her. Also, her brother-in-law and some other needs that she has shared with me. So let's pray for her. Sister Lorraine, she had heart surgery here a year or so ago, and she's been having some complications with that the last week or so. So we want to pray for her and her body. Of course, Brother Pooler, we want to continue to lift him up in our prayers, and Sister Renee and all their family and their church as well. Brother Michael Brown, his brother Ricky, is not doing good. He's been in the hospital for several days, and he needs a touch in his body, needs a miracle, and just needs God to touch him. He's been this way one other time. And me and his mom helped pray him through it. So we're just believing the Lord to touch him. We pray, and most of all, Lord, save his soul. Continue to pray for Sister Martha and her body. We want to pray for Susan Chase, Lee Johnson, Jacob Sparkman. All of them are battling cancer. We want to continue to pray for Jack Wooters and his body, and his son Kevin as he goes through cancer treatment, Geraldine Kersey and her body. Sister Mosley's sister, Louise Herndon, and her body. She got a report this morning. She's feeling some better, so we're going to continue to pray for full recovery and full healing for her tonight. And I just went down the whole prayer list tonight, but if you have a need on my right that you would like to add to the needs tonight. All right, up the middle. Sister Emma. All right, let's pray for Sister Emma's mom. Sister Debbie. Amen. Let's remember these two needs. Anybody on my left? Pray for him. It was good to have Casey and Tiffany with us this morning. Let's pray for that young family. Ask the Lord to touch them. He told me they'd be back next week, so let's lift them up in prayer. Anybody on the platform?
But Jimmy, I have a cousin that his grandson this afternoon went in to have heart replacement surgery, and I haven't heard anything from it, but it was going to be like 4 or 6 hours or something like that. He's 13.
Wow.
And his name is John.
Amen, amen. A couple of those that I had mentioned with cancer, I believe it was Jacob Sparkman is 19 years old, and one of the other ones was 6 years old. So let's pray for them. Let's pray for these needs and ask God to touch and to move. Maybe you have an unspoken request this evening. God sees those hands tonight. And, of course, our lost loved ones, all of our lost loved ones, we want to pray for them. Let's pray for this service tonight. If you will, stand with me. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Let's take these needs before the throne room. Father, we're grateful for the privilege that we have to once again be back into your house tonight and to come before you with our requests and our petitions, Lord, to be made known before the throne room, God. We've called out all of these names. You've heard every request throughout this room this evening, God. And we know, Father, that you knew the needs before we ever asked. And There's those that need healing in their body. There's those that need you to go before and guide the physician's hands. And there's those that just need a supernatural move of your spirit. And most of all, there's those that need salvation. And Father, we come tonight knowing that you're more than able to touch from the most minor need to the most significant and life-threatening need, Lord. There's none that's too big or too small for our God. And we just yield them all into your hands and surrender them all into your will and your way. And know, Father, that you're faithful as promised to minister to these needs and to manifest your purpose and your plan for every situation and every circumstance, Lord. And we just pray, God, that you would rain down in each one of these homes, each one of these families, each one of these lives, God. Every situation and every circumstance is different, God. But you know the complexity of each one of them. And I know tonight that you're faithful as promised to intervene and to touch and to bless and to help and to move in behalf of the needs of this hour, God. And we just surrender this service to you tonight. Thank you for the opening service to know that blessed be the name of the Lord. And Lord, your name is holy, and we give glory and honor unto you tonight. And as we continue on in this service, we ask you to anoint the songs that are sung, the words that are spoken. Meet with us in these altars, dear God. Touch us in every aspect of this evening, Lord, and we yield it all to you and give it all to you, and know tonight that you're faithful as promised to intervene in the move on behalf of every situation and circumstance. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated for a moment. I want to go over just a couple of things immediately following service tonight. After altar service, don't go anywhere. We're going to have our quarterly meeting, the last quarter of 2020. We can close out 2020, so we'll be reading the quarterly report immediately following service. I don't have any new order of business to bring up, so it'll just be simply reading the report. Shouldn't take us but just a few minutes, unless there's a lot of questions on the report, and then we'll answer those questions. So it should be just a few moments. And next Sunday is our 71st anniversary service. And also, we're going to relaunch Sunday school, so 9:30 next Sunday morning. We've been 10:30 last few weeks being back, but 9:30, we're back into the routine next Sunday morning of Sunday school. I know our Sunday school teachers are excited to get back into the classroom, starting a brand new quarter in our Sunday school material. So that will start next Sunday morning at 9:30. Our service, morning service, will be 10:30, as we said, celebrating 71 years for church, 8 years for me and my family. And we've got so thankful for the Lord for the opportunity to be serving here, for that longevity and to continue on with that. So we're going to be doing that, and I will be preaching next Sunday morning. And the next Sunday night, 5 p.m. service, we'll have the Duncans with us, Duncan Ministries, and they'll be doing a gospel sing for us, Southern Gospel. So we're looking forward to having them with us next Sunday night. So invite some folks to be with us, some that may have been a part of the church in years past, and maybe they've got away from church, or maybe God's placed them somewhere else, but they want to come and celebrate with us 71 years. Just put that invitation out, and especially believing the Lord just to touch hearts and lives in these services next week. Revival has been bumped just a little bit to the week after Easter, so be praying and fasting for revival. I'm expecting great things in revival. And looking forward to having Brother Eddie Sullivan back with us. So that will start on April 5th, that week, so at 7 o'clock each night, Monday through Friday. So be praying and fasting and preparing for revival coming up in just a few weeks. So we're looking forward to having Brother Eddie and looking forward to what the Lord has in store for us for revival. Sister Pat's going to come at this time, lead us in some congregational. So let's worship the Lord with her as she's coming. If you'll stand and get ready. Go do your la la la, get your voice ready, get your praise on, get your hands ready, get them out of your pockets, and let's worship the Lord tonight, amen. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty, and I believe that the Spirit of the Lord is in this place. So don't hold back. We're Pentecostals, as I said last week. They've already placed all the names on us, so let's live up to our reputation, and let's just give God praise tonight and give God glory and just allow him to have his way in this service tonight. Come on, Sister Pat.
Everybody turn to page 214. He knows how.
Thank you.
page 110.
Place that he's prepared for us. I'm looking forward to that place. Looking forward to a city whose builder and maker is God. He is faithful. Faithful as promised. And I want to serve him until the end. Praise the Lord. Do appreciate all of those that gave this morning and for special offering for the Poolers. And we want to give again tonight. If our ushers could come to this evening. And let's give as given unto the Lord. Gracie needs your help tonight, babe. Riley, can you help us tonight, hon? Be an usher? All right. You give tonight as given unto the Lord. Once again, tonight's floor offering and anything marked CPR or Poolers will go to the Pooler family. And you have already exceeded the $1,000, so we appreciate that. And so thank God for that. Amen. So we appreciate your response this morning. And looking forward again tonight for whatever you are able to give. And give is given unto the Lord. And I tell you this, I should have said this morning, but I think you know this. Poolers don't want your tithes. Amen. Tithes stay here, but going above and beyond that and giving in your offering. And I'm thankful to you. Appreciate you. And just thankful for your heart for ministry and for ministers such as this. And the struggle that they're facing is real right now. So thank you so much for your response already. Father, we're grateful for the Poolers and what they mean to us and what they mean to this church. And we just pray once again for healing and blessing, and praying, God, that the financial response from this church and other churches will be enough to help offset and take care and meet the need that they have for these medical bills and different things that have come to pass over these last several months. And on the financial side, we know that you take care of us all the way around. So we know that they're in your hand and in your care. And we just thank you for being a part of your response to them. And we just praise you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you as you give tonight. Thank you so much for your giving tonight. Appreciate your support once again of the Pooler family, and I know that it would mean the world to them. Sister Diane's coming at this time to sing for us, and immediately following her, Brother Paul will be coming to preach this evening. So we're looking forward to what the Lord has for us in song and in message. And just let God speak to you. I don't know about you, but the Lord speaks to me through songs just as he does through sermons and Sunday school lessons, and the Lord spoke to me through billboards and everything else over the years. And God finds a way of speaking to us. Just let God speak to your heart tonight. Listen to the message in the song. Listen to the message and what Brother Paul's got to bring tonight. All of it's for one purpose, and that's to get us to this altar. And to get us, why do we need to get to the altar, Pastor? Because we need to make sure that we have everything that we need to face a world out there that needs us to be operating and kicking on all cylinders. When we step into that workplace and to that schoolhouse or wherever you go throughout the week, there's a world out there that needs us, the church, to be the church. They need us to be as advertised. And Jesus said, these things you see me do, you'll do these and even greater. So that's how we've been advertised through the Word of God. So I don't think that the world should expect anything less from the church than power and authority and anointing. And the Spirit of the Lord is upon us for that purpose. So if we're not in that place tonight, let everything that takes place in the remaining part of this service help you to make sure that you get yourself positioned in that place for a world that needs us to be what God has called us to be. So worship with Sister Diane as she sings, and immediately following her, Brother Paul will come.
This is a repeat, but I haven't sung in like 3 months, so you won't notice, right? But I've had several people ask me about this song to sing it again. It's got a nice little beat to it, so here we go.
A city that looks o'er the valley of death, and its glory has never been told. Where the Lamb is the light in the midst of the night, in that beautiful city of gold, where the sun never sets and the leaves they never fade.
Hey, it's my night, not yours. Who'd y'all come to see tonight? You can come to see me. Come to see Jesus. Probably took me 2 or 3 weeks to put this together. All right, so let's get into it. All right, if you're staying with me for the reading of God's Word, we're going to turn to Acts 12, 1 through 6. Now about that time, Herod the king stretched forth his hand to vex a certain of the church, and he killed James, the brother of John, with the sword, and because he saw it pleased the Jews, he proceeded further to take Peter also. Then were the days of unleavened bread. And when he had apprehended him, he put him in prison and delivered him to four quarterns. Is that how you say that? Thanks. Of soldiers to keep him, intending after Easter to bring him forth to the people. Peter, therefore, was kept in prison, but prayer was made without ceasing of the church unto God for him. And when Herod would have brought him forth the same night, Peter was sleeping between two soldiers, bound with two chains, and the keepers before the door kept the prison. In this walk of life, the enemy has one goal, one mission, to place chains on our soul that bind. Let's pray for God to help us. Lord, I'll be your willing vessel. I pray that you would help me deliver your word. Pray for the people to hear, hearts to receive, and that we would all walk in your will, in your way, even though we might not understand it, but that we'd heed to your will. And we give you honor, glory, and praise for it in Jesus' holy name. And everyone said, in this passage, Satan relentlessly attacks the church. This time, the persecution comes from Herod the king, Herod Agrippa the first, the grandson of Herod the great, the same Herod that tried to kill the baby Jesus. He was appointed king over Judea by the emperor. See, I did that. Roman Emperor Claudius, an observer of the law of Moses. He went to great lengths to please the Jews. He harassed the church, killed James, the brother of John, with the sword. The Jews responded so enthusiastically to the execution of James that Herod was encouraged to do the same thing with Peter. However, it was then the day of unleavened bread, and executions were forbidden. They were frowned upon on the religious holidays. The Jews would be too busy with their ceremonies to enjoy the favor. So Herod ordered Peter to be jailed until it was over. Peter was guarded by 16 soldiers, 4 squads of 4 soldiers each, and he was attached between 2 soldiers with chains that bind. We are looking at the beginning stages of the church, and Satan is trying to change the chain the Lord's kingdom before it ever gets going. It's the same with us. When we're born, the devil starts to try to chain us down, trying to keep us submitted, bound, trying to keep us away from the kingdom. I was born into a family that was ruled by a narcissistic father. When I say I've never been scared of the evil, I ain't lying. I've seen it incarnate. I was a strong-willed child. And to a narcissist, that's a threat. So a narcissist cannot feel empathy, so he craves it. There's a spectrum, I believe. Narcissist on one side, empathy on the other. The balance is in the middle. The narcissist is all the way to the inside. They can't feel empathy. They don't understand it. So they crave what they can't have. He feeds off of it in others. They are attacked they are attracted to an empath because those people are full of empathy. Empathy is the ability to understand and to share the feelings of others. Narcissists are unable to do this, so they attach themselves or seek out an empath. They use tactics and manipulation to feed their narcissistic tank until the one they have attached themselves to is used up. My mother was an empath. At first, he would have been charming, sweet, loving. But once he attached those chains, it spells doom for the empath. But the narcissist can't keep the charade up. It's like watching a movie. The only empathy that they know is what they have seen, and it's a mimic behavior. But eventually, they can't hold the charade any longer, and it becomes what they really are. So as my father couldn't keep the charade up, then he would get mean and violent, then he'd be sweet. This vicious cycle gives the empath hope for once was, and now comes the chains that bind, because now she's caught in this cycle. And the narcissist continually manipulates the empath to change their manner, their perspective on how things should be. As a strong-willed child, I was a threat because I took my mother's time away from him. His control over her was in jeopardy, and he couldn't control me. You can imagine I was probably much like TT back there. So instead of embracing it, he looks at it, I'm a threat, and he can't do anything with me. So then it becomes a war. He would use tactics that played us against each other. I was used as a scapegoat. He would use gaslighting. Gaslighting is where manipulation is used by psychological means to make another one question their own sanity. I was probably about 8 or 9, I guess. We had like a clamp-on drop light. It was big. Had one bulb in it. I didn't have a light in my closet. I asked my father if I could, hey, can I use that for a light in my closet? He said, yeah, sure, that's good. He went out, was gone for 2 weeks. I don't know, training something from the Navy. Come back, looking for his light. Where's my light at? Well, I've got it. I didn't tell you you could have that. The game starts there. So as he tried to convince me that I lied and I stole it, my mother's trying to back me up, and it all gets twisted. It ended not really good, as you can imagine. He was also an alcoholic. So it's just, it's brutal. And I've just had to actually relive all of this because the Lord's trying to show me something. What? I can't tell you. I guess because the programming that I suffered as a kid is technically not who I am. So my identity does not rely or is not based off of what my father has done or said. When we are born into sin, warriors against God. That's a chain by itself. Amen. And the devil doesn't want his warrior children to roam unchained. The more powerful the warrior will be for the Lord, the more chains the devil attaches. Whether it's drugs, alcohol, depression, sickness, thoughts of suicide, deformities, ailments, sexual sins, worthlessness, you can insert whatever chain you want. So let's get this into a visual perspective. Raven looks like me, so we'll use this. All right. Here's young Paul. We'll call him Little Paul. All right, Little Paul, you were born into sin. You get you a chain. Time goes on. Things happen. You're a kid. You get accused of stuff. Your label and what you have been perceived as gets you another one. Man, they're almost like rewards, aren't they? But they're not. Is that getting heavy?
A little bit.
Is it? Well, hold on. As you get older, you get into drugs and depression from all this manipulation that has been posted upon you, whatever it is, it's not necessarily me, whatever has been done to y'all, whoever, it's just a matter of time. Get some drugs and depression. Actually, how about we do this? Is that going to work?
Yeah.
Is that good? Here, we'll do this. We'll get the other ones I got. Is that getting heavy? Yeah. Is it? Mm-hmm. He'll be all right. Wears them chains well, don't he? So after years and years of chains being applied, now the devil thinks he's got you. Right? Here, we're going to hook this to your belt loop. He's attached to good. He's got you. The devil's like, come on, boy. I see you go out in the world. We'll make a war of you yet. Right? That's how that goes. Is that how little Paul's out there doing what little Paul wants to do? I was made to believe that I was never going to amount to anything, that I was stupid, useless, and worthless. He tried to break me. The devil uses the same tactics, and even though my parents divorced when I was 11, the damage was done. All those feelings of worthlessness carried over to every aspect of my life, and from then on until now, caught between two worlds. And when I was told, from what I was told to what I believed about myself, was a war within. I know what you're thinking. Wait, when you were saved, Jesus should have taken that all away. But he doesn't, does he? We have to examine ourselves, because our identity does not hinge on what we have done, what has happened to us, or what anyone says. It's about what Christ says we are, and we have to be reprogrammed. The chains that bind are of the devil. What'd you stop for? Were they heavy? All right, well, keep walking. Just walk back and forth here. That's good. Just so I can hear them rattle. In Genesis 35, 16 and 18, Jacob and his family are traveling. Rachel is pregnant with her second son. The Bible says she had hard labor, and because of this hard labor, she was dying. And her soul departed as she named her newly born son Benoni, son of my sorrow. Seeing her death and pain, she named her son Benoni, son of my sorrow, son of my mourning, because she was in great distress. She was losing her life. She was scared. But after her passing, Jacob said, I don't think so. His name will be Benjamin, son of my right hand, son of my strength. That's the chains that bind, the chains the devil wants to put on us. If they have left his name Benoni, he probably would have battled depression for sure. Everyone would have seen the son that had killed his mother. And maybe he still did battle it. I'm willing to say that he did. The devil don't give up that easy. So if he's fighting this label, whether it's in his mind or with someone calling him out and coming against him, he would have to fight hard to overcome it. Maybe that's why on Jacob's deathbed, he prophesies that Benjamin would be a mighty warrior. The tribe of Benjamin was known as fierce warriors, the smallest tribe, but yet the most formidable foe in battle. Trained to use the sword with both hands. They were skilled with the bow, able to put an arrow wherever they wanted. Proficient with the sling and the stone. They were so good with it, they could hit a rabbit and not miss. A warrior tribe matched by no other in combat. And you look good. Some good chains there. They're getting heavy yet? So then we go to the Battle of Gibeah. Shows the warrior tribe's strength in battle. This is how they were. In Judges 20, a gang of Benjaminite men killed a Levi slave woman. The Levi tribe wanted justice and vengeance. They got together with the other tribes, 11 total tribes. The 11 tribes gathered 400,000 soldiers, men trained for battle, to pressure the Benjaminites to give up the gang of men that committed the crime and to rid Israel of the sin. The Benjaminite tribe said, "We're not giving anyone up. Don't come here demanding anything. We don't play that game." I'm going to paraphrase it. That's actually not in the Bible. So don't go looking for it. "We will handle our own business." And they gathered 26,000 soldiers for battle. 26,000 against 400,000. Man, that's quite a big difference, isn't it? The first day, the Israelites sent the tribe of Judah to fight the Benjaminites first. The tribe of Judah was appointed leaders over all the tribes. They marched into battle, and the tribe of Benjaminites killed 22,000 Israelite soldiers. I don't think it actually says how many the tribe of Judah was there, and I couldn't find it when I researched it, but I'm sure it was probably quite a bit. The second day, the army of Israel goes out to fight the Benjaminites. Not just one tribe. See the difference. The first time they sent the tribe of Judah like a father to spank them. That didn't work. So then they all had to get together. "Now we'll get them." So the whole army goes out and they lose another 18,000. Well, by this time, they don't know what to do with them. The army of Israel goes to the Lord. And after much prayer and fasting, after much offering and worship, they asked the Lord if they should fight. The Lord said, "Go, and I will be with you." See, the Israelites lost the first two battles because they didn't have God's blessing. In the Bible, they actually asked, "Should we go?" The Lord said, "Go." But they didn't do anything beforehand. The second time, "Should we still fight? They're all brothers." The Lord said, "Go." But he didn't actually give a blessing to anything. He didn't say he would be with them. He just said, "Go." They didn't do what they were supposed to do. They didn't pray. They didn't fast. They didn't worship. They didn't ask God for his counsel. So they lost the two battles. Are they getting tough? Okay, I was just asking. When they got serious and they weren't driven by vengeance and they asked the Lord for help, is when they were able to defeat them. Because they asked, but they weren't serious. That is a chain that binds. You can't fight the devil on your own because of emotion. You have to take your emotion out of the battle. No matter how bad it hurts, fast, pray, and seek God. He will be there. In the third day, the two armies faced off again, and this time the army of Israel prevails, almost wiping out the Benjaminites, but only with God's help. Some battles you will never win on your own. Some chains that bind will never be broken without the Lord's help. Some battles you can fight and win on your own. Some chains you can break on your own, and some you cannot. The Lord is our strength, our healer. He fights for us when we cannot. Why? Because we have to learn to rely on him, learn to trust him at all costs, because we don't understand always. The devil has been waging war for a long time. He has thousands of years of battle experience. Why are some battles harder than others? Because some chains run deeper than others. The army of Israel could not do anything with the Benjaminite tribe because man to man they were no match until the Lord stepped in. Why couldn't they defeat them? They were all Hebrews, right? They were all the same bloodline, same chosen people. One might think they could have all the same skill. But the Benjaminite tribe was not just another tribe. They were a warrior tribe. They were loyal to each other and whoever they committed themselves to. They had zeal, a fierce determination to do whatever it takes to get the job done. My mother used to say, whatever Paul is going to do, whatever he sets his mind to, he will go over, under, or through it. And I can remember that being said numerous times throughout my life. Which is funny, because I actually just found out through DNA testing that I have some Jewish heritage. I'm 5%. Isn't that crazy? All these years we were told, oh, yeah, we got some Native American Indian in us. That's probably why you're so dark. Greek, German, Italian, Turkish, Jew. So in researching this, I didn't really understand all this stuff. And as I'm like, all right, Lord, why did I need to see that I have Jewish in me? And what does it mean? I can't exactly trace it all back. And so as I'm researching stuff and I'm looking at, and I come across the tribes, and as I'm looking at the tribes, the Benjamin stands out. So I start to read what their character is, and I'm like, oh, I got some of the same traits. Isn't that crazy? Can I prove it? No. But at the time I was researching all this, I woke up. Me and Amanda woke up. I hadn't told her anything about what I was looking for. And she said, hey, does the name Benjamin mean anything to you? And I'm like, man, I was kind of groggy, still asleep kind of. Yeah. I got some friends named Benjamin. Yeah, this so-and-so I went to school with, this guy I used to party with. She's like, no, like family. And it was something washed over me. And I was like the tribe of Benjamin? She's like, I guess so. She's like, all I heard was Benjamin. I'm like, man, isn't that crazy? I don't know. If I can ever prove it, that's my goal, is to actually be able to prove if I can trace it back. But if the Lord told me, that's good enough for me, right? We see that in the Benjamin tribe, that determination. Who came from the Benjamin tribe? King Saul, Queen Esther, Mordecai. Mordecai was a guy that told somebody he wouldn't bow down to him, an emperor or a king, right? So he's like, I ain't bowing down to you. I don't bow down to no man. Yeah, got him in some hot water, didn't it? Anybody else in here done that? That's me. My mouth will sometimes get me some hot water. Who else was in that tribe? The Apostle Paul. Oh, what a mighty man of God he was. It always wasn't like that, was it? See, Paul had one mission, to eradicate the first followers of Christ. And he was going to do whatever it took to get rid of them. He had them arrested, tortured, and killed. He was loyal and zealous to the law and the way he had been taught. But just like Jacob, somebody stepped in. As Jacob stepped in and said, we're not calling that child Benoni. His name is Benjamin. The Lord saved Saul, changed his name to Paul, and gave him a new focus. Pointed his path in a different direction. Paul didn't just make a 180, did he? He made a 180, and everything was not just hunky-dory. Everything didn't just come to pass, and he was on easy street. Woo, I'm working for Jesus. Everything's easy now, isn't it? He suffered a lot. He had battles and struggled, suffered for Jesus' name. One of those struggles he writes about in 2 Corinthians 12 and 7. And lest I should be exalted above the measure through the abundance of the relation through, where is it at? There was given me a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure. I haven't actually found it. Everybody says he was probably walking with a limp. Most scholars say that because of the scales on his eyes, he had cataracts or glaucoma, some kind of eye issue. I don't think that was it. I think Get over here, little Paul. I think as Paul walked his walk, the devil would come around and be like, you can't save these people. You tried to kill them. You're a murderer. You know what you did? Hold on a minute. Let me get a hold of this chain. Oh, yeah. Come on. That's how he works, right? He's trying to pull Paul back. He knows Paul has that zeal and he won't give up easy, so he's got to chain Paul down. That's what he's going to do to all of us. If it's one chain, it's two chains. See the Lord? Hey, you dropped the chain. Here, I'll get it. There we go. So Jesus comes and he saves us and he says, whew. All right, that chain's gone. Now you're going to have to work out your own soul salvation. I will help you with the battle. Amen? Is it heavy yet? Paul asked the Lord three times to remove it. And the Lord said, what? My grace is sufficient. Paul knew what he had done, and he probably had to live with that guilt all his life. But the Lord had told him, my grace is sufficient. That's a chain that we carry, and it's hard to break. What we've done in the past, the devil's going to use all that. Is it heavy yet? Want me to get the other one back on there? Just kidding. You were saved. Finally. Uh-oh. Now. So, when we first read our text, it was Peter we were looking at, right? Let's find out what happened to Peter. Up until this point, James has been beheaded. Peter's awaiting the same fate. Chained to two soldiers. And guarded by 14 more in a cell. The devil's got him right where he wants him. Satan has that loudmouth preacher in prison, chained in silence. The fight is over. What is Peter doing? He's sleeping. Not a nap. He's passed out. I guess he figured he had been working pretty hard. He was like, well, you know what? I'm going to go ahead and use this. I'm going to take a nap. Acts 12, 7 and 11. And behold, the angel of the Lord came upon him, and a light shined in the prison. And he smote Peter on the side and raised him up, saying, arise up quickly. And his chains fell off from his hands. And the angel said unto him, gird thyself, and bide on thy sandals. And so he did. And he saith unto him, cast thy garment about thee, and follow me. And he went out and followed him, and wist not that it was true, which was done by the angel, but thought he saw a vision. When they were past the first and the second ward, they came unto the iron gate that leadeth unto the city, which opened to them in his own accord, and they went out and passed on through one street, for with the angel departed from him. And when Peter was come to himself, he said, now I know of a certainty that the Lord hath sent his angels and hath delivered me out of the hands of Herod for all the expectation of the people of the Jews. Peter was sleeping so hard that he didn't see the light. The angel had to hit him to wake him up. The sleep was so deep, the angel had to tell him to get dressed and to put on his shoes. Peter still thought he was dreaming until he got past the gate on the street before he realized the Lord had delivered him. And some of us were so used to the chains that we were in a deep sleep with them all. We just walk around and carry them. We're used to it, right? And don't realize the Lord has removed them because we believe that they're a part of us. And sometimes I think we hold on to some of them chains because we've had them for so long. They will hurt when they are removed. But the chains of the bond are the devil. The Lord won't rip them out. You have to let go of them. No matter how bad it will hurt, the Lord will be there from the removing the chains to escaping the prison. He will see you through. So as the Lord comes down and you release, you get rid of these chains, you're going to have to let go of them. Look, I didn't give you the spirit of fear. I didn't give you that. Whatever, you can insert whatever you want. Maybe you need a healing. The Lord says, those are mine. Chains are broken. A little lighter now. You walk through life a little better without them chains, right? Amen. So in closing, it's time for us to rise up as a warrior tribe. Time to show that determination and zeal that Paul had, that the tribe of Benjamin had, that we are going to make it through it no matter what. To show the devil we mean business, but not to rely just on ourselves. Greater is he who is in me than he who is in the world. The devil's not going to let us go without a fight. He will try to bind us and keep us bound. But no weapon formed against us will prosper. Jesus will remove and break every chain if we call on him so we can run. No, so we can fly from every chain that binds. Now I'm going to turn it over to Brother Jamie so he can close for another 20 minutes. Just kidding.
Amen. What stuck out to me tonight is, you say, I'm saved. All chains are gone. You know, I've preached it. We've all preached it. God doesn't unlock the lock. He breaks the chains. But we're only bound by what we allow ourselves to be bound by. Brother Paul, and I believe it was Brother Paul and I, was talking a few weeks ago that I told him and made this statement about a picture that I saw of, I think it was a couple Sundays ago, of a horse that was tied to a lawn chair, one of those white lawn chairs. The horse wasn't moving. And that horse felt like it couldn't move. But we all know a horse could have just drug that lawn chair. So many things that the devil will tell you. Don't matter if you're saved or not. Don't matter what has happened. No matter that you're changed. Devil, all that doesn't really matter to him. You can profess to be a Christian as long as you still walk around bound by the same old stuff that you allow yourself to be bound for. Bound with. But look at all these chains laying all over the floor tonight. And I know Draven's thinking tonight, not tonight's the night that Dad decides he's going to preach a little longer. Well, I'm carrying chains around. But he's not carrying those chains. Those chains that once held him bound, now laying at his feet. That's for little Paul, big Paul, and all of y'all. Right? But that's his story. That's the message. But how many chains are still binding those in this room tonight? You know, so many times people try to witness or whatever to us. We say, I'm saved. Didn't ask you that. We talk about all the good things that we've done. I pay tithes. Didn't ask that. Paul was one of the greatest men to ever walk the face of this earth. But he said it was just that thorn in the flesh that he spoke about. The messenger of Satan to buffet. I don't think you could have put it any better than exactly what he said. The devil will come up and you ain't some great man of God. We look back and we say, man, that's a great man of God. But I guarantee you that he never felt like he was a great man of God. He felt like that he had to overcome such a reputation. Listen, don't let the devil feed you that line. Don't let the devil bind that chain to you. Paul, don't let the devil do that to you to say you got to overcome some reputation of who you were. Because that's not who you are anymore. Any of us, that's not who we are anymore. Devil wants to bind us to that. You made that mistake, so you have to live with it and you got to die with it. No, he died at Calvary. Not just to set me free and not just to save me, but to totally redeem me. To completely restore me. And that means that every chain will be laying at your feet. So as you stand with me here tonight, I just want you to be honest.
I want you to be honest with yourself. God already knows. But can you truly say tonight that you can stand there and say, without a doubt, there's no more chains. There's no more chains. I preached a similar message years ago at a street service, and I didn't recruit somebody. I drug the chain around myself. But I was a lot younger than Paul is. But I drug that chain up and down in front of that hardware store, that sporting goods store where we were at, and I was preaching. And I threw all the big chains down. Man, that's a relief. Each one of those chains came off as a little bit of a relief, wasn't it? And all those big chains are gone. But then I got to the end of my message, and I said, we think we're all right. And I reached down in under my shirt, and I had just a little necklace on. And I was preaching from McClendon Church of God, so there was some gas when I had a necklace on. He has on jewelry. But I pulled it out, and I held on to it, and I quoted the scripture. It's the small foxes that spoil the vine. You think all the chains are gone, but there's that one thing, that one little chain. It's not as heavy as those big chains of addiction. It's not as heavy as those big things that you overcame, but it's still holding you back from being everything that God wants you to be. So what did I do that night? I jerked that chain off and I chunked it across that parking lot. I don't know if anybody ever found it again. It's up to us. God's broke all those big chains, but God's looking for somebody to take hold of those small things and bind. So you're not binding me any longer. And I'm reminded of a scripture we've been talking about a lot on Wednesday night. Sanctify yourself today that God may do wonders amongst you tomorrow. Do you want to see wonders? Do you want to see revival? Do you want to see restoration? Then be honest with yourself tonight and say, there's some chains that are binding. There's some chains that need to be released. God's going to break some chains, but God's leaving it up to us to pull some chains off ourselves and throw them aside. So who be willing tonight to cast aside every weight, every sin, every chain that would beset you tonight and say, I'm making up my mind tonight. No more thoughts of insignificance are going to hold me back. No more thoughts of inadequate is going to hold me back. No more thoughts of somebody else can do it better than I can is going to hold me back. No more thoughts of I'm not good enough. No more thoughts, whatever it is, that's hindering you or binding you. And maybe it's on the other end of the spectrum. No more thoughts of I'm the best in the world. There's nobody that can do it better than me. I have to do it because nobody else can do it. Whatever end of that spectrum you're on tonight, I believe God's saying to somebody, I've broken a lot of chains in your life, but I'm about ready to see you grab hold of that chain and disconnect from it. God's breaking chains, but he also said he'd give us power and authority over things that bind us too. So who's willing to break free from the chain tonight? Get away from that little lawn chair. Get away from that, whatever it is that's binding you and holding you in that place, because there's work to do. There's victories to be won. As I said at the beginning of this service, there's a world out there that needs us to live up to our name. Needs us to live up to who God has called us to be, full of power and authority and anointing. So as I pray tonight, you just be honest with yourself. If there's chains, if there's things holding you back, deal with that in these altars tonight. Heavenly Father, thank you for the message tonight. Lord God, thank you for the reminder that no matter how saved we are, there's still chains that will try to bind us, hinder us, and prevent us from being all that we're supposed to be. And too many times we're satisfied with just dragging those chains around, keeping them, and thinking, well, that's just a part of who I am. That's just a part of my nature. It's just how things have to be. When you said, he who the Son sets free is free indeed. Lord God, you've come to completely save and redeem and restore. You don't leave us as a patchwork, but you leave us completely restored if we're willing to walk with you and trust in you and do what we're called to do and be what we're called to be. Move in these altars tonight as folks make the decision to break free from every hindrance, every binding force, to not only have faith in you, but faith against the hindrances in their lives. We'll praise you for it in Jesus' name.